by this company was what you're doing is wrong.
For the last 18 months, the issue of healthcare and the behavior of the entire healthcare industry has been making headlines. Whether it's Republicans trying to dismantle the few improvements that have been made to the healthcare insurance system or greedy pharma executives, price gouging consumers. Americans are being fed a steady stream of news regarding the healthcare industry, and that's exactly what Big Pharma wants. The news might not always be flattering, but as long as the public is only focused on price gouging, then they aren't talking about the opioid crisis that pharma created, a crisis that's claiming the lives of tens of thousands of American citizens every single year. In 2015, there were more than 52,000 deaths in the United States attributed to drug overdose. About two-thirds of those deaths came from the opioids like OxyContin or Percocet or heroin and fentanyl. But that's more people than died from auto accidents or firearms in the United States. Big Pharma's argument is that they can't control whether or not a person overdoses on medication. But when you start to dig into the issue a little deeper, it becomes clear that the drug company executives knew this was going to happen, but they did nothing because they knew they'd get rich off of overdoses. According to 2015, the study published in the Annual Review of the Public Health, there's a direct correlation between the increases in opioid prescriptions and the increase in overdose deaths in the United States. And that's a correlation that drug company executives have known about for a very long time. To understand Big Pharma's role in this crisis, you have to go back to 1990s when these opioid-based painkillers were released. At the time, the FDA, doctors groups, and even drug company sales reps were concerned about the addictive quality of opioid painkillers. They understood that patients could easily become addicted to painkillers and that these pills were very easy for patients to overdose on. But rather than demand that drug companies carry out extensive testing, these groups were more than happy to accept the drug companies' ridiculous lies and their assurances that their painkillers were less addictive than other opioids. That's all it took for doctors. Doctors clearly knew better, though. That one lie from drug companies, a lie that continued for more than a decade, is what led hundreds of thousands of Americans to become addicted to opioid painkillers. Their doctors told them that these pills weren't addictive because the drug companies swore to them, to the doctors, that they weren't addictive. They made it sound like there was something magic about the opioids. The drug company Purdue, who makes OxyContin, had to pay out more than $600 million in 2007 after lawsuit proved that executives, lawyers, and medical officers for the company were lying, pure out lying, when they told doctors and they told the public that their pills were less addictive and more effective than other painkillers on the market. Purdue exaggerated the effectiveness and safety of OxyContin while covering up all the criticisms and the complaints about the drug. And if you want to know why they did this, look no further than this. 1996, it was a memo of a Purdue sales manager telling her staff to urge doctors into giving out stronger doses of OxyContin. Sell them more, she said. The memo is literally titled, "It's Bonus Time in the Neighborhood." Similar allegations have been made against other drug companies that make opioid-based painkillers, and at the root of each of these stories is a company's never-ending quest for more money, more profits. And right now, American taxpayers are the ones footing the bill for the deadly disaster that Big Pharma created. For more on the opioid crisis, let's go to attorney Jeff Gaddy, who's representing groups that have been harmed by opioid painkillers. Jeff, take us back to the beginning here. How did drug companies manage to get away with the big lie that their opioid painkillers weren't addictive? Because that's what they were telling doctors and that's what they were telling patients for 10 years. What's your take?
You're exactly right, Mike, and thanks for having me on. The short answer to your question is that the companies got away with this by weaving a web of lies. Look, opioids have been used for decades to treat short-term pain management. I'm talking 1 or 2 days after a surgery or a trauma incident. But what these drug companies figured out was that if they could find a way to convince the medical community that they could use these opioids for long-term pain management, weeks or even months, that what they could do was they could turn their millions into billions. And that's what they've done. At the time, they knew they couldn't do it with science because the science was against them. And so what they did, and it's quite incredible, Mike, but what they did was they went back to their archives and they found a letter to the editor of a medical journal from 1990 where two doctors had written in and provided some anecdotal evidence that they did not see addiction in some hospital patients. And what the drug companies did was they took this letter to the editor, five sentences long, and they cited that letter hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of times. And they used that letter and they used other bogus evidence and that they used it to convince the doctors and the healthcare providers that opioids were not addictive and that they used it to perpetuate the myth that opioids could be safely prescribed for long-term use. And look where you are. You just mentioned that in 2015, we had 52,000 deaths. The New York Times just came out this week and said last year it was up to 59,000 deaths. So the problem's just getting worse.
Well, look, to be clear, from what we've seen from the documents, some of these cases, it's absolutely clear. It's clear that drug companies knew how addictive these painkillers were. Yes, as you got it right. They were telling the doctors, they were telling patients that ours is different, that our painkiller is much different. But there was really no question while they were saying that, regardless of what this journal said, that the opioids aren't addictive, their own studies were showing that they're absolutely addictive. Did I get that right?
There's no doubt about it, Mike. And it's a story that I know you've seen in your line of work time and again, corporate greed. Like I said, these companies knew that they could turn their millions into billions by perpetuating this lie. And that's exactly what they did. Don't think for a minute that this 1980 article had any scientific value in it whatsoever. The authors of that article are shocked and astonished in the way that, excuse me for calling it an article, that letter to the editor was used to perpetuate this lie. But no, these companies, like you brought up Purdue Pharma, the maker of OxyContin, they pled guilty to criminal violations. McKesson, one of the biggest pharmaceutical distributors in the country, paid $150 million in civil penalties to the DEA. Cardinal Health paid $44 million. But just like you said, Mike, this is the cost of doing business to these folks. One of these companies had an internal motto of get them high and hope they don't die. This is their business plan.
Now, there are a lot of different areas of litigation with opioids, Jeff, but one that's been received, I guess the most attention, is the suit that's been brought by the Cherokee Nation. Can you tell us about that case? And these are the kind of suits that I understand you're handling. You're handling cases on behalf of cities and counties. There's a lawyer in West Virginia. It's way ahead of everybody. His name is Paul Farrell, just a brilliant young trial lawyer that is actually breaking. He's the one coming up with this new methodology to go after these companies. Paul Farrell, I think, is his name. I think you've worked with him. Tell us kind of what's happening out there generally to push back to these companies. What's happening?
You're right about the suit that was brought on behalf of the Cherokee Nation that has received a lot of attention for two reasons primarily. First, you're talking about a population of individuals who just historically have been treated terribly, and as it relates to the opioid epidemic, they've been hit just as hard as anyone else. Unfortunately, as they've alleged in their complaint, it's a population that is more prone to addiction, and they've been absolutely preyed upon by the pharmaceutical industry as it relates to these pills. The second reason that I believe this suit has gotten a lot of attention is that not only did the Cherokee Nation go after, I'm not talking about Fortune 500 companies, I'm talking Fortune 25 companies. They went after some of the biggest companies in the U.S. And not only did they go after them, but they filed a lawsuit against them in tribal court. So they looked these big companies in the eye and they said, we're going to hold you accountable and we're going to do it on our own turf.
This is what Paul Farrell is doing in West Virginia, too. I mean, he's taking county by county, city by city, where we see that they've dumped the opioids in there. The taxpayer has to pay for the cleanup. The county loses huge amounts of money. And then there's this, we got quickly, tell us what the tail is. Once the opioid comes in and everybody's addicted and then the opioid leaves town, what's left, what they call the tail of the disaster? Explain that.
Well, what we've seen, Mike, and what the tail is heroin. We've seen state by state get proud of themselves and pat themselves on the back for shutting down pill mills. And what they're now finding out state by state is that when the pills dry up, the heroin moves in. It happened in Kentucky. It's happened in Ohio. It's happening all over the country. And it's just a matter of time before it's happening everywhere.
Jeff, I think what's going to be important is that the suits that you're, kind of lawsuits you're bringing on behalf of counties and cities and states, and along with Paul Farrell, I think your methodology is brilliant. And I really do believe that in the end, that's what's going to be the biggest pushback here. Full disclosure, I'm involved with that also. But for the life of me, I haven't figured out any way to go after these companies other than simply taking their money away from them. They're huge profits because they've made billions of dollars at the expense of people's lives. Thanks for joining me. Coming up, we'll take a look at one of the biggest reasons why rapists rarely get convicted. Stay tuned. Every year, there are about 300,000 sexual assaults committed in America. And while this number has fallen by more than half since 1993, the vast majority of these cases are never solved. According to RAIN, the country's largest anti-sexual violence organization, for every 1,000 rapes, 994 perpetrators will walk free, even though more than 300 of these assaults were reported to law enforcement. One of the biggest reasons for this lack of prosecution is that tens of thousands of kits containing forensic evidence collected by medical examiners from sexual assault victims are sitting on the shelves of police departments all across this country, and they've never even been tested for DNA. In fact, there are as many as 400,000 of these completely unexamined DNA kits nationwide. Joining me to talk about this crisis is Natasha Alexenko, sexual assault survivor and founder of Natasha's Justice Project, an organization trying to eliminate the rape kit backlog, which is where we begin. Natasha, can you start by telling your story and how you got involved as an advocate for this extremely important issue?
Well, certainly, and thank you so much for having me today. I myself was raped and robbed at gunpoint by a stranger in 1993. To say that it changed my life is a grave understatement. Of course, it not only affected me, but affected everyone in my life, my family, my friends. It was absolutely devastating. And, you know, I was a college student at the time, and I had a specific path and goal in life, and that all got derailed. It was very, very difficult. I submitted to a rape kit exam immediately following the assault. Of course, your first instinct is to take a really hot shower, but your body has become a crime scene. So it's important to ensure the integrity of any evidence that can be found on your body so that the evidence can be used to eventually find the perpetrator. Having gone through that really grueling process, unbeknownst to me, that rape kit that was taken so meticulously, that was so very difficult to take, sat on a shelf collecting dust for 9.5 years.
What do you think are the biggest factors that led us to the point that we are today, where there are as many as 400,000 untested kits sitting on the shelf across this country, like you've described? I mean, it's the heart of the examination. I mean, it's the heart of what a prosecutor needs to get a conviction. What's happened to where they're just sitting on shelves now? It's an outrageous story.
Yeah, it is truly an outrageous story, and we have a right to be outraged because this is a public safety issue. You know, the man that raped me was on a nationwide crime spree, a whole bunch of different crimes, burden on taxpayers, burden on law enforcement, so it's something the public should be concerned about. How we got here, I wish there was like one specific thing because then we could easily take care of it. But certainly DNA is a technology that has developed far quicker than we're able to, you know, as far as like keep up with, understanding that it's such a great investigative tool. That's certainly part of it. The second part of it is really encouraging law enforcement to gain training to understand the neurobiology of trauma, what a victim after assault goes through. You know, we were reading through reports where kits had not been submitted, where a law enforcement official simply said, she was laughing during the interview, I don't think it's a plausible rape. And, you know, not understanding that there, after that kind of trauma, we all have different reactions. The body has a way of just, you know, making us act in ways that perhaps we wouldn't conventionally think a rape victim would act, like solemn, crying. They may laugh, they may be completely quiet in a state of shock. So really there's been a great effort to train law enforcement to understand how a victim reacts after that kind of tremendous violence.
In New York City and Los Angeles have both been able to clear their rape kit backlogs. How did they do that, and what should we learn from their examples? Why could they get it right, but we have police all over this country that don't seem to be able to get it right? What's the difference?
Well, certainly New York City has a really innovative district attorney. The NYPD is wonderful. Everyone goes through significant amounts of training. And when New York City had 17,000 rape kits that were unprocessed. And what they did was they tested every single one. They just put them out on pallets. They sent them out. They tested what they could inside. And New York City was really in a unique situation. The reason why between 2000 and 2003 we were looking at 17,000 rape kits was because they weren't connected to CODIS, which is a national database. It's like the fingerprints, but it's for DNA. So you're able to find a perpetrator, like in my case, a stranger with their DNA. So they weren't connected at that time. You know, now we're in 2017. We're connected to CODIS. So there's really no excuse. And people really should take New York City as an example, because we're looking at a 70% arrest rate for rape in New York. That number is far less than the rest of the nation. It's almost like rape isn't a crime, truly.
Yeah, let me ask you, another major issue that we see constantly is, in these cases, the statute of limitations. In some cases, mm-hmm. When it comes to prosecuting sex crimes, this is the biggest obstacle. How has this problem impacted the fight for justice for sexual assault survivors? I mean, here, part of the problem is, let's not forget where we started. You have an officer that's taking a kit where we have DNA. It's going to show us, it's going to help us understand who is this person, who's the perpetrator. But it sits up on a shelf, it's never tested, we never find out about the DNA, and the perpetrator goes on to rape somebody else, and somebody else, and somebody else. So give me your take, first of all, the statute of limitation issue. Don't we have to get better control of that, I think, nationally?
You're absolutely right. And I think certainly prosecutors are coming up with innovative approaches to the statute of limitations. In my case, after 9.5 years, we were nearing the 10-year statute. Now, New York State no longer has a statute of limitations. But in order to stop the clock, essentially, on the statute of limitations, on my case, we did what's called a John Doe indictment. So that was essentially charging the DNA in the rape kit with the crime, even though we didn't have a perpetrator. And that way we were able to, you know, not worry about the statute of limitations looming towards us. But really throughout the country, prosecutors and law enforcement have found innovative ways around the statute of limitations. Of course, some states, advocates have worked so hard to eliminate the statutes in various states across the country. But in states where, even though the statutes have changed, they still have to go by the law prior to that being changed, like California, they're able to show a pattern. So they may not be able to bring that case to trial, but they can show a pattern in that particular criminal and that he had other hits in the CODIS database. There's other sorts of things like that. In Texas, they allow kits that have passed the statute of limitations. They allow those survivors to give a victim's impact statement at the trial of the perpetrator who's perhaps, you know, coming on for another crime that didn't, you know, that was, you know, in the statute of limitations. So that's really innovative ways we're doing it. Is it unfortunate?
Yeah.
Absolutely. Okay. I mean, so it's so unfortunate. It's an archaic law that was developed before we had DNA, which doesn't forget, when we were primarily dealing with a witness and what, you know, their memory. How long does memory last? Well, we know it doesn't last as long as DNA.
Yeah. Well, look, thanks for joining us, and thank you for the work that you're doing out there. I hope you continue to make inroads here. It sounds like you're making some important inroads already, so thank you for joining us. The United States joins Syria and Nicaragua, is the only countries in the world to reject the Paris Climate Accord, really. But Trump's decision to pull out of the global agreement may not be as simple as it seems. Joining me now to talk about that, is about the legal issues surrounding the Paris deal, is Mollye Barrows, legal journalist with the Trial Lawyer magazine. You know, Mollye, first of all, what's the deal supposed to do?
Well, essentially, it's voluntary, really. All these countries have come together and they've said, hey, we're going to come up with these individual voluntary plans to reduce greenhouse emissions. The United States has agreed to attempt to reduce greenhouse gas emissions by up to 28% by 2025. Well, each individual country, each individual plan is voluntary. The legal requirements come in when they start talking about accountability and reporting. And even those legal requirements are more about global peer pressure, if you will, coming together every 5 years to set goals as established by science, taking a look at those goals, reporting if they've met them or not to the public as well as to each other. And but again, that goes back to more of a global peer pressure, but that's where the legal requirements come in as far as what the United States has agreed to do and what they're bound to with this agreement.
Well, you know, what the process of pulling out of this thing is not that clear cut.
No.
Explain what's involved. I mean, Trump just thinks, okay, well, I'm going to announce it, therefore I'm going to pull out. It's a little more complicated, isn't it?
As with most things, I think, that this president tries to take a stand on, it's not as simple as it would come across. We just signed on in November of last year. It was an executive order signed by President Obama under his administration. But and according to the Paris Agreement, you can withdraw, but you have to be, you can't, the earliest you can do that is 3 years. So we're looking at November 2019 before we can even legally give notice that we want to withdraw. And then you still have another a year before that withdrawal is even effective. So we're looking at 4 years down the road, November of 2020, before we can even effectively get out of this if they decide to withdraw just from the Paris Treaty alone, or the Paris Agreement.
So that's an obstacle. Are there any other obstacles right now, or is that the biggest one?
Yes, that's one of the biggest ones. Now, there is another angle that they could take, which is to withdraw from the United Nations Global Climate Change Agreement, a treaty, if you will, that they agreed to in 1992. Now, that was signed by then-President George H.W. Bush, and it was also ratified by the Senate. So that's going to be a little more complicated if they decide to go that route. By exiting that treaty, they would essentially pull out of the Paris Agreement as well, because that's the foundation for all these countries to agree that something needs to be done about global warming, about climate change, what can we do to have our role in it. The Paris Agreement is really about the steps to take to reach those goals. So if they don't want to go through the lengthy process of withdrawing from the Paris Agreement, they could go through a quicker process of trying to withdraw from the 1992 agreement. Well, I say a quicker process. If they actually withdrew from it, if they successfully withdrew from that 1992 treaty, then they would be out of it in a year. But the problem is, because it was ratified by the Senate and also signed by then President George H.W. Bush, he may have to get congressional approval in order to withdraw from the 1992 agreement. And remember also, Trump's also saying, well, hey, maybe we won't pull it all together. We just need to renegotiate. And they're like, oh, no, you don't get to do that. I'm sorry. One party wanting to renegotiate, you can change your contribution, but we're not going to let you just pull out.
It's almost as if nobody gave him the legal analysis before he did this. And the worst thing is, now we, as a world leader, we're in the back seat. China's at the table. Other countries are at the table in leadership positions. It affects us in the worst kind of way. Thank you for joining me on that, Mollye. The story to me is incredible. Finally tonight, a Philadelphia grandmother's long legal nightmare is finally over. Back in 2013, 70-year-old Elizabeth Young lost her house in a car after the Pennsylvania state government seized the property because her son had sold less than $200 worth of marijuana out of her home and vehicle. Despite the fact that Young herself was never charged with any crime, prosecutors went ahead with a process known as civil asset forfeiture and confiscated the home she lived in since 1970s. Prosecutors argued that they were allowed to do this because her car and house facilitated, in their words, her son's minuscule drug sales. Well, thankfully, the Pennsylvania Supreme Court has ruled that the government's seizure of Young's property was wrong. In a unanimous opinion, Justice Deborah Todd wrote this. She said the amount of forfeiture must bear some relationship to the gravity of the offense that it's designed to punish. Just common sense, isn't it? Unfortunately, Young's case is hardly unique. In Pennsylvania alone, police confiscated more than $118 million worth of cash, $12 million in vehicles, $20 million in property, and between 2000 and 2013, all of that happened. While this decision won't stop these seizures from taking place, it should serve as a warning to prosecutors that they better be prepared for major legal challenges if they continue to engage in this crazy, unconstitutional behavior. Papantonio, and this is America's Lawyer, where every week we tell you the stories that corporate media is ordered not to tell you because of their advertisers. They won't let them, like the opioid story we told tonight. Have a great night.